This video is going to be the second part to the skin texture painting tutorial. On the screen now is a completed painting with the textures and details falling off as we move toward the bottom. This way it focuses the viewer right on the face. All the information about the tools used and the color mixtures for this painting, as well as a bit of art history, is in the first part of this video, which I'll link down below in the video description. So picking up where we left off in the first video, we're going to be finishing up this right eye. So here I'm using the lighter and warmer flesh tone to start adding some of these creases above the eye. And as I talked about in the first part of the video, to add some of these creases above the eyelid, I'm using a ripped piece of paper. This is just a normal sheet of copy paper that I tried to tear a straight line in, and you get these little imperfections, which are so amazing to spray, because when you spray them, you get kind of an organic edge that looks way more natural than what you'd get from a ruler, or if you're using something like a shield or a French curve. So now I'm switching over to my eraser. I'm pulling out a few of the highlights just above these creases. What I'm also doing is slightly erasing the creases, because when you spray with an airbrush and you're using a shield, sometimes you spray them a little bit too dark, but the great thing about canvas is if it's too dark, I could always lighten it down by erasing into it. This also adds some texture and some imperfections to the line, so each line's not perfectly straight. If you look closely at the reference photo, you'll notice that these creases have somewhat of a texture to them. So I'm going to use the texture template that we made in the first part of this video and spray it very lightly over the top using the exact same color. Remember that when you're spraying any texture like this, you're essentially spraying in shadows of pores and bumps on the skin. Each one of those is going to need a corresponding highlight, so we're going to use an eraser or an electric eraser to pull those out. Switching back to my airbrush, I'm spraying a light coat just over the top of these creases, and then also I could help define the brow ridge. If you're working in a subtractive technique like this, your bright areas and your highlights come from the white gesso underneath. So now that we have a thin layer of paint sprayed over the top of these creases on the skin, when I erase into them, we could see our highlights much brighter and much clearer. The reason I love using gessoed canvas is because I can decide how bright these highlights are by the amount of pressure I use on the eraser. When you're using some other papers on the market, the thing that I'm not crazy about is when you erase into them, it's basically all or nothing. You can't decide how much you want to pull out by the pressure you use. When you erase, it basically just pulls out pure white. So with gessoed canvas like this, we have much more control over our image. This also works on any other gessoed surface, including paper, wood, or panel. Now that I have the highlights in, I can see that I want the shadows slightly darker. So I use a ripped piece of paper and just sprayed a small amount of paint under each one of the highlights. When you're adding in skin texture, you don't need a template. You can do this freehand. As you can see just above the creases, I'm adding in small wavy lines, almost like small figure eights. Once we put these lines down, we can see that this looks very similar to the texture template. The reason I like using a template, though, is it gives much more randomness. In the first part of this video, I talked about one of the problems that we always have is that if we're painting, we like things in order. So if we're painting something that has to be random, we're generally going to put a pattern to it, and we'll do that unconsciously. So it's nice if you could use some tool to help randomize any sort of sequence that you're painting in. For the rest of this, I'm switching back between my airbrush and my eraser, constantly looking back at my reference, because that's going to tell me where I need to put textures and where I need to put highlights and dark shadows. Now, there are many ways to paint. In my opinion, there's no right ways and there's no wrong way, so it's up to you to decide. But for me, what I really like to do is I like to think of an airbrush as a give and take type method, where I add some paint and then I use the eraser to pull it out. And then when I erase, it's generally too light, so I have to go back to add some paint over it with the airbrush. And this is this constant cycle that you go through, adding, removing, adding. And then you stop when you feel like you're in a spot where you're happy with the texture that you got. In no way do I think this is a great painting or an amazing portrait. It's okay in my opinion, but it's essentially just a demo showing YouTube viewers, you guys, how to paint various skin textures. But if you're looking at this and thinking you could never paint this way, I promise you, you absolutely can. The secret, if there is one, is learning to hone your observation skills. If we're working on mimesis in painting, meaning copying things from life, including a photograph, we really have to focus in on our observation skills and learn to try to replicate what we see. And I think the photograph is such a great tool to do this, because a photograph is a snapshot of life. It's a still image that's not going to move on you and the light's not going to shift. So you have to focus on small sections at a time and really look at what you see and then do the best you can to try to replicate that in your painting. And I'm well aware that's easier said than done. But if you're new to painting and you're scared of failing, you have to learn to accept it, because failing and making mistakes is just part of the process of painting. And if you're critical about your work, it's going to make you a better artist, because you're going to notice things that you want to change, and eventually you'll build up the skills in order to do it. So going back to the painting, we're going to skip over the hair because this tutorial is all about skin texture. So moving along to the ear, I'm going to mask off the contours using some of this 3M vinyl tape. Now this size is 1/4 inch thick. Then I just use some Normals painter's tape to block off the rest, and I fold one piece to kind of create a dam to prevent any overspray from spraying over the blank part of the canvas. I'm putting the photo reference up on the screen now so you can see what I'm working on. So like everything in airbrush painting, it's always best to start with the lightest color. So I'm using the first flesh tone mixture to start painting in the helix of the ear here. Now the helix is the top part of this ear. It's kind of the skin that folds around. And I'm using this French curve to help define the edge where that highlight is right here on the top between that and its shadow. So when I'm painting, I like to switch off between using a shield and just doing it freehand. Now in this area of cartilage that kind of bows out, this is called the anti-helix. And the transition between this and the helix is that dark area, which is called the anti-helical scapha. And that area is really dark in this. It's being cast shadowed by the helix itself. So I'm just going to paint this in freehand. Once I have those contours marked in, I'm going to paint in this whole area right in the middle. And it's always important to build this up slow because this is going to be a very dark area. So just do it in multiple slow passes. Let each one dry for, about 10 seconds or so. And then go back and lay the second layer over. If we look at the reference photo where this highlight on the helix is, you can see that there's a lot of texture. So I'm going to use this texture template and lightly spray over the top of it just to lay down some of those shadows. You could even see that when I'm putting these down, they're incredibly light, but that's what I want. I want them light, kind of marking off a few areas, and then I'll spray over it to darken it up, and then I could decide how much darker I want to go. You could see right here that I darken this area up by putting another coat on, and that's about a minute or two after the first few layers dried. And just like before, we have some of the shadows in on the helix and anti-helix, so we're going to switch over to the eraser, and I'll start up here on the helix and pull out a few highlights, and then I'll work my way down onto the anti-helix and try to pull out highlights just to the right of every one of those small shadows that we placed in with the template. As I move down to this cast shadow, I used a shield first to help define some of the edges, and then I'm switching over to freehand and filling this in. And freehand here is going to help soften up those edges that we defined first with the shield. A shield is great to use, but sometimes it just makes a line way too sharp. So you can kind of switch between the two. You could spray very lightly with the shield to define an edge, and then switch over freehand and fill in the areas around it. And that's going to help still give you a sharp edge, but that overspray is going to help soften it up so it's not too sharp. And for these dark cast shadows, I'm using the second mixture, which is in the first part of this video. Since that color is fully transparent, if I spray it lightly, I get a nice cool shade. And if I spray it dark like this with the cast shadows, we almost get a pure black. So it's great to have that control from one or two paints. I just want to point out that I'm filming at a sharp angle, so my painting looks slightly distorted from the reference photo. But as you can see, in a few minutes, just by adding down some values, we're able to get a basic shape of an ear. From here, we're just going to spend more time by switching our attention to the micro details, adding in some more of those textures, and adjusting the values to make it look as close as we possibly can to the reference photo. I'm switching between my two different erasers, the first being the Dremel tool, which helps add in those very sharp, small, circular highlights, and then going over to my the pencil eraser. This is called the Mars eraser by Staedtler, and kind of using small circular motions, almost like little figure eights all around different sections of the ear to help break up and add some randomness to the texture so it's not all just dots from the Dremel tool. You may notice here that my ear is way lighter than the reference photo. That's what I always want in my airbrush paintings, because if it's too light, it's no problem. I could just take one of my transparent flesh tones and lightly spray or glaze over the top of it to darken those values down. If it's too dark, the only way to adjust it is to erase into it or switch over to an opaque paint and spray over it, and that's just a lot of extra work. So it's always best to stay light like this, try to get your values matching, and then adjust the whole area, the macro area, as needed. So switching back to my lighter flesh tone, I'm going to do exactly that. I'm going to spray over this whole area. This is called a glaze. It's a light transparent color over the top. That's not only going to shift the color, but it's going to shift the value to make it darker. And while I'm doing this, I can also adjust some of the areas and add in some subtle textures just by spraying in different areas, maybe spraying some darker dots in some areas and some shadows, and just kind of playing around with it to see what sort of effect I can get. As we can see here, the ear is darkened now, but it's still too light, but that's good. That's what we want. We always want to slowly creep up on the final value. While I'm painting this ear, I'm not thinking about anything else in the portrait. For me, right now, the only painting I'm working on is this ear. If I look at every other part of the portrait, I'm going to get overwhelmed very quickly. So it's good to kind of block off one section you're working on to make it easier on yourself. At this point, I want to compare my painting with the reference, and what I like to do is squint my eyes. So here, I'm putting a blur on the screen, which kind of simulates squinting your eyes. And what it does is it forces you to see the macro values, the large areas of highlights and shadow. It's kind of like blocked in areas, and it helps you see the whole thing a lot easier to make decisions on what you need to change. Squinting your eyes also blocks the micro values. It makes you focus in on those macro values. And at the end of the day, when you're working on a portrait, the macro values are way more important because that's going to define the shape of the entire image and the entire portrait. So I'm going to stop the ear here for now. I'm going to start adding in the skin texture, and eventually I'll come back to the ear later on and adjust it to match the rest of the portrait. Switching over to the side of the face, the first thing I'm doing is starting with the pencil to help mark in the lines where these macro values are going to shift from one value to another. This way I just have kind of a guide or a map to paint by. This next part is very simple. I'm using the texture template with the lighter flesh value that we mixed in the first part of this video, and I'm going to spray it over this whole open area. Now, I'm not going to go too far and jump around, like, you know, all the way down to the chin or to the mouth. I'm going to stick in a smaller area just around one part of the cheek and slowly build these up. And as soon as I lay down any sort of color, I back away and I look at it and see what I need to do, you know, if I need to adjust it or add more. And within a few minutes, we have a decent texture down, and the whole point of this is just break up that white uniform color of the gessoed canvas. As long as you take your time and you don't add these textures in too dark, you shouldn't have any problem with it. So now, using the exact same flesh tone, I'm going to start spraying over the top of this to adjust the macro values on the face. And this color is transparent, so we're not going to lose any of those textures we placed in underneath. Now, if I just left those textures underneath without any highlights on them, what we'd get is we'd get something that looks like discoloration of the skin, maybe something like freckles. But any sort of pore or bump on the skin is going to be raised, so it's going to have a 3D shape to it. So if we want this to look like pores and skin texture, each one of those shadows are going to need a highlight that's going to help it make it look like it's a bump on the skin or a bunch of bumps adding to a texture. So now, as I start defining the rest of the shapes on the face here and the structures underneath, you know, the skeletal structures, what I'm doing is I'm switching between freehand painting and using this shield, the texture template, to add in textures where I feel like they're needed, where an area may look, you know, slightly too smooth, so I could spray some more on top of it. But what I'm doing is I know that I'm going to eventually come into this with an eraser to pull out highlights. So this is the first step of the texture. We're working on the micro values, which are the little bumps, and then of course we're adding the macro values, which are the shapes of the face. Not going to paint the nose yet, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to define some of the shapes, the contours, along the outside of the nose, like where those darker shadows are. This way I have a reference to know where the skin texture is going to stop, right? That area between the ear and between the nose. And it just gives me kind of a guide or a map to know where these major values are going to be on the skin. Since I'm going to be resting my hand on the canvas while I'm using the eraser, I place down a piece of paper. This way it protects the paint underneath. If you look at the left side of the video, you'll see that I have my photo reference next to me at all times, so I'm using this as a guide to help add in these highlights that I'm adding in right now. Now, it's very important to try, if you can, to print your image. This way you have an image which is reflected light rather than one that's emitted light, which you get from looking at a monitor or an iPad, something like that. When you're looking at emitted light, something from a screen, the values could shift by, you know, what angle you look at it from, or the level of light in the room, if the room is dark or light. It's a lot more difficult to see the values naturally. So if you can, I recommend picking up a good photo color printer and using that to print your references. It's going to help you a lot in the long run. It just makes everything so much easier. So moving down to where the beard is, we're going to start by adding in these hairs using the airbrush. Now, when we do this, these hairs are going to look softer, like they're farther away from us. And to add more detail to it, I'm going to switch to a colored pencil, a black Prismacolor pencil. And it's really nice to have a variety of textures, even for something like hair. The airbrush is going to give softer looks, like maybe hair clumped together or hair that's slightly out of focus. And the colored pencil is going to give us much more sharper, defined hairs. So we're going to mix those two as we work with this. While I'm spraying in these little hairs, I'm trying to hold my airbrush close to the surface and spray them very quickly in small, kind of like zigzag motions, or small, like curly circular motions. And once those are in, I have a basic texture of the hair. I could spray over the top of it with the exact same color and darken the major or the macro value of that section. Since we have the texture shield, why not add some of this underneath the hair? It's going to make it look kind of like maybe some pores underneath or maybe some smaller cutaway hairs. So again, you know, it's really about trying different techniques to adjust your textures. I wasn't planning on using this texture shield for small hairs, but I tried it and it seemed to work just fine. So it's always good to kind of experiment and try different techniques. Looking back at the reference photo, we can see that there's a very dark cast shadow right here underneath the beard. So it's good to first put in those textures of the hairs and then spray that exact same color. This is the second flesh tone, the darker color, and spray that right over the top of the whole area to darken it down. Just like in the eyebrows, I'm going to use a few different erasing techniques, both the eraser and an airbrush needle. This is going to pull out some highlights, make it look like some lights catching hair. And then when those are pulled out, I switch back to the airbrush and spray back over it. Switching back to our lighter transparent flesh tone, I'm going to spray this over the beard and start defining some of the areas like the jawline and the areas around the mouth and nose. Just like before when we added some of the shadows around the nose, I'm going to do the same thing around the bottom part of the mouth, you know, on this lower lip. Just going to map in some of these shadows and this dark cast shadow so I have a bearing of where my textures are going to end, you know, my textures from the actual flesh tone. And once again, this video is way longer than I thought it was going to be. So we're going to stop here and next time we'll finish up the lips and the nose. But for the time being, I'm just spraying the rest of this transparent flesh tone over the face here, knowing that I'm going to come in later with my eraser and pull out some highlights in it just to get some basic colors and values down. In the next and last part of this tutorial, we're going to be working on the mouth and the nose, and I think they're such important parts of the portrait, along with the eyes. They're one of the first things the viewer sees, so I want to make sure I spend plenty of time working on those and showing you the way I paint them. If you made it through this whole video, thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something, and I hope this was helpful. So I'll have the next video up in a week or two, and I'll see you then.